A very good afternoon to one and all. Today, we have gathered here for the keynote address by Ms. Mridula Ramesh, author and founder of Sundaram Climate Institute. I request our conference chair, Dr. Sriram Narayanan, to please introduce our guest for today. So please.
Well, good afternoon all. It's a pleasure to introduce Ms. Mridula Ramesh. She is the author of a well-regarded climate solution, India's climate change crisis and what we can do about it. She's also the founder of the Sundaram Climate Institute, as you just heard, which focuses on waste and water solutions and education. She's an active angel investor in clean tech startups with a portfolio of over a dozen startups to their credit. She sits on several angel management groups, including the Indian Angels and the Chennai Angels, and is involved in several initiatives to spur entrepreneurship to build climate resilience. She is a graduate with distinction of Cornell University with majors in chemistry and microbiology with an MBA from the Kellogg School of Management. She worked for McKinsey in Silicon Valley before returning to India. Leveraging her 2 decades of management experience, she teaches a postgraduate class on climate change at the Great Lakes Institute of Management and is a regular columnist for the First Post on climate change and has written extensively for the Hindu newspaper. She is the executive director of Sundaram Textiles and lives and experiments in Madurai in a net zero waste house with her husband and 2 children. On a personal note, I think we go back more than 20 years, that's all I can say, and she's been a great friend, and I'm so glad that she accepted to come here. And incidentally, I did read her book from first page to the last page because I was really curious. And this is the second book that she gave me that I had a chance to read. So please, Mridula, thank you so much, yes.
Good afternoon. Thanks for inviting me, Sriram. It's a pleasure to be here. We've known each other for many years, and anyone who knows Sriram, the best compliment I can pay is you remind me of your dad. A bundle of energy and getting things done, which is a very, a wonderful quality to see in someone in academia also. It's a winning combination. So thank you. Thank you to SP Jain for hosting this and inviting me. My understanding is the conference's theme is data and decision making, and I want to separate those 2 words and focus on them individually. So specifically data and decisions in climate change. To start off, I want to share about 5 to 6 pieces of data. So can I have the video, please? So the video you're about to see is a visualization of temperature changes that have happened over the last 130 years. This is, it's a comparative temperature change to a baseline. So as in everything, yellow means warm, red means hot, blue means cold. Okay, so with that, we'll... That's today. So this is the first data point. The world has warmed by about 1 to 1.5 degrees in the last 130 years. And there is surprisingly an almost universal scientific consensus. I think 97% of climate change scientists agree that this current warming is caused by greenhouse gases that resulted from human activity. This brings us to data point 2. In the early part of the 20th century, the greenhouse gas was known. I mean, people understood that carbonic acid, as it, carbon dioxide was called then, caused the greenhouse gas. But there was significant disagreement on how exactly the role was played, because most people believed that carbon dioxide levels varied across the globe. It was higher in the equator, it was lower in the Arctic, it varied across the seasons. It took data and data measurement, but by one person, this is called the Keeling curve. And this man started taking readings in the 1950s. Then that's all he did. He took readings for decades. And that is what resulted in the Keeling curve. So he started taking readings here and showed that A, carbon dioxide levels were constant across the world. There was just one reading that existed across the world, and they rose every year. And that's really what was the fingerprint that identified human activity as lying behind this current recent warming. So that's data for you. I mean, climate change, more than any other field, really needs good quality data and is reliant on it. Now, let's come to data point number three. 1 to 1.5 degrees, when I talk to someone, I think somewhere, if people are honest in this room, you'll think it's not a big deal. It's just 1 degree. I mean, if you go from here to there, it's not a big deal. But what 1 degree does is warmer air tends to hold more water vapor. And that changes the water cycle. So you get rain, wetter places like Bombay can receive more rain on fewer days. Right, it'll start holding up more water vapor, and it'll rain less often, but more quantity. So think of a big bucket becoming a bigger bucket and emptying on fewer days. So you get the kind of downpours that you have. So you have flooding, but the converse is also true. So drier places like where I come from, Madurai, will get drier, right? And that's a big deal. Because, so wetter regions, there are fewer rain days, rain tends to fall in the thing. But the third data point that I want to know, and something that's not really understood, is that India, we're a poor country. I mean, we're a poor country with a large number of us, more than half of us, directly dependent on agriculture. This combination, and we have a huge population also, and we're warm, and we're already water scarce. This combination makes us the single most vulnerable country to climate change in the world. And that's something that's not really understood. So a leading investment bank did put numbers to this. So they put data to it again. And they said, you know, what are the risks? How sensitive are you to these risks? How exposed are you? And how much capacity do you have to adapt? Like, take a country like Israel, and we're going to look at them a little later. Israel is more exposed to risks. They get far less rain than we do. But because they're small and they're so highly educated, they have fantastic data, as we'll see, they can adapt, but we can't. So this is the third data point, right? So this is how exposed are you to climate change risks. So the more you come here, the more exposed you are. And the y-axis is about how able are you to adapt to climate change risks. So the higher up you are, the more able you are to adapt. So you see, you know, the Scandinavian countries, climate change is, this is the dirty little secret of climate change, as I call it. There are many countries in the world who will benefit from a warmer climate. It makes sense, right? If you're snowbound, you'll get longer growing seasons, you'll have a nice longer tourist season, you'll have lower heating costs. If you're Netherlands, you have cause to be concerned because you're already lying below sea level. But many countries have a lot to gain, and many of those countries have already, you know, emitted a lot. So this is the next data point. India does not play a big role in causing the climate change problem. This is, again, you know, something that data shows very clearly. And here, that's my phone. Since I assume that everyone here has a data interest, can I assume that? Okay. So the next slide after this is going to be a little technical. So what I want to say is this is global greenhouse 2013 emissions, right? And it's about, if you see, China is number one. It causes 24% of emissions. America is 13. The EU 28 is about 8%. I split this out. India is overall about 6%. The entire electricity sector of India, where all, you know, many of you, when you hear of climate change, you say, shut down the coal plants. That's 2%. And for data scientists, this is pretty important. So the people who put this out is the World Resources Institute. They take their emissions data from a number of different data sets. They get their fossil fuel data from IEA, right? There is an alternative set of data that comes from the UNFCCC. The problem with that is that data doesn't have a long enough time series for us to look at, you know, trend lines and look at historical responsibility. And also, it doesn't cover all the countries as much. So they've made a compromise and chosen the IEA. But look at this. The global CO2 emissions, the uncertainty is fairly low at 8%. Okay? But greenhouse gases is not just carbon dioxide. You have other gases like methane. You have the perchloro gases. You have nitrous oxide. The uncertainty there is methane. They just say, oh, it's only around 20%. N2O is about 60%. And other, you know, the forest, which is what the number that really swings this number year on year, like, is 50 to 75%. Those are the uncertainties. And I'm just going to go back to the previous slide. Look at the amount of press coverage given to the 2%. If you are in climate change at all in India, you will keep hearing about India's coal. If you have an error bar, and I'm really happy to be talking about, you know, to a group of data scientists, because I don't need to explain it to you. If you have error bars, the good quality data of 8%, how much credence would you give to the 2%? Okay, and I'll give you another secret. Climate change works with long inertias, right? You put 1 ton of carbon dioxide today up in the atmosphere, 50% will get taken out by the ocean, by the plants, by photosynthesis, by the soil. But it has a long tail. You know, the deep ocean circulation takes about thousands of years. Then you get the big chunk goes away in weathering, which takes hundreds of thousands of years. So if you're to judge blame and assign responsibility, you have a longer time frame to take. And the share of India goes even smaller. It's 6% for 2013 emissions. It becomes like 2 to 3%. Again, think of the uncertainty in that. So now let me come to the next data point, where I believe we should really focus on. Here, the data is again not clean. So this is, at the end of a good talk, you always ask your audience for something, so I'll come to that, but I hope I'm building up my case for that. So this is India. That's the world average. That's 2014 water availability. It says World Bank, the development indicators. The data, I won't bet my life on it. Directionally, I think it's right. And this is what I really want you guys to focus on. We're not much better than Syria, right? And you know the kind of problems that Syria went to. So my whole approach in climate change has been the narrative in India, you know, perhaps because of a lack of appreciation of the data that's actually available, and more importantly, the missing link between the data that's available in the scientific community and the data that's being used in popular press or popular narratives, is that we keep talking about carbon and carbon emissions. We're not going to be able to impact that much there. Whereas in water, there is, you know, only now, whenever there is a crisis, we have like some frenzied attention and it goes away. But we have absolute, the quality of data and water is almost absent. And that's where I would really ask us to focus on. Because India, one thing we are fairly certain about is our population. We have about a fifth of the world's population, right? And we just have 1/33 of the world's fresh water. And that's a problem, right? Would you focus on something where you have a 2% share with an 8% error uncertainty interval, or somewhere where you're asking a fifth of the world's population to survive on just 3% of the world's water? I mean, I come from a management background. I mean, given these two choices, I know where I'll start focusing on. The other thing is that India gets its water in a very seasonal fashion, right? We get most of our water supply through the monsoons. So if you have low water, which is seasonal, and you have an increasingly spread out demand curve, so how would you stretch it out? Yes, pre-lunch session, I'm asking questions. How would you stretch it out? Exactly. That's India's storage, right? So that's the world storage, and that's India's storage, and I apologize for the blue ink which doesn't show up. All this data is 2015 data. Our data is 2005 data. So not only are we are bad at knowing how bad we are. Right? And that's a problem. Because that's why my plea for data comes in, because you're pretty bad you're asking one-fifth of the world's population to survive on 3% of the water. You get your water seasonally, and you're bad at knowing how bad you are. And you're really bad in storage. And that's something that even experts in the field, get surprised about. So we not only do we need data, we need the data to be publicized. So when you put all this together, there is one conclusion that I reached, which is, we're focusing on mitigation, which is getting our carbon emissions down, when really what you should be focusing on is adaptation, which is learning to live and thrive in a warmer climate. Because emissions are not falling. We are talking about emissions going to zero, but they're still rising, right? China is picking up its economy, and with that, the emissions are rising. Usually when I teach a class, I have a few Trump videos that I show. Transport emissions in US are rising. So there is, the warming's not going to go away, like unless the Earth's orbital tilts or something, which I won't bet my house on. So I think we need to focus on adaptation. But for adaptation, you need to not focus on a national level. You need to focus on a regional, preferably a city or a district level. Can anyone tell me why that is? No, but why? Climate change happens globally. It's a global phenomenon. Why do we need to focus on a regional or a city level? Not quite. Resource characteristics are different. That's resource. But let me tell you, so this is a graph of some of the changes predicted to happen in India in 2020 to 2050, not very far away. What's the first thing you take away from this graph? The colors are different, right? They're not a uniform color across India. So that's the whole thing. Like, climate change is a spatially variable phenomenon. So how Bombay will get affected is very different from how Madurai will get affected. And you're right, Bombay's resource characteristics, or how close you live to water, is very different. When, for instance, when I talk about water in Madurai, usually get a packed hall. When I spoke about water in Bombay, not too many people come. When I talk about waste in Bombay, packed hall. So what interests you is very different in different places. So you to adapt to a warmer climate, where some, like Bombay, it's likely that the rainfall that you get will go up, and you will get it in more staccato bursts, intense rainfall events, which means what should you be prioritizing? little more. Flood protection, right? So let me give you another data point. There is a paper that was published earlier this, recently in Nature Climate Change that predicted $100 billion of storm surge damage, flood damage in Bombay by 2050. $100 billion a year. It's a big number. Has anyone heard this number before? No, it didn't make it to popular press that much. And I'll think there is two reasons for that. The authors were candid in admitting that the data for property damage, property values and property damage in Bombay weren't there. So they had to adapt that data from other countries, which definitely, I mean, if you were a person who didn't want to pay a tax to build the kind of, storm surge prevention wall or something, if you said the data is adapted from another city, what is the first thing you would say? That's rubbish data. I don't believe that $100 billion number. See, $100 billion a year is a huge number. It's difficult to accept, which means what you rest it on, the data you rest it on, has to be gold standard. And if that's not there, you will find a lot of pushback. The second problem is, again, this. Academics tend to do a lot of good research. And something I hear repeatedly, especially after I read the book, is, how come I didn't know this? This is all public domain. There is nothing, there are some things that are paid for, but all of this is available in the public domain. But how many of you knew that India's coal plants are only 2% and the error bars were 8%? Whereas you do hear all the time that India is one of the major emitters and our coal plants are a gift from the devil. I mean, that's something you hear all the time. But what the data of the scientists getting out, so I mean, that's something I'm going to ask you, ask all of you, that data communication is something that you want to think about. Drier regions will need far more granular data, which is also completely absent, by the way, to adapt. And I'm going to give you an example, two examples on what can happen, the power of adaptation if you have that data. How are we doing on time? We're okay. So the first example I'm going to use is Israel, right? Israel gets a lot less rain than India does. So in terms of exposure to climate risks, they're very, very exposed to climate risks, right? But Israel doesn't suffer. Israel has become water independent. And the reason for that, at least part of the reason for that, is because of the phenomenal quality of data they possess. Every house, every farm, every office in Israel is metered with a working meter and very often a smart meter. And what that allows is that the decision makers in Israel know precisely who is using how much water, of what quality, at what times. And that's something that is completely, and because of that data availability, Israel is called the startup nation, right? So they've turned their innovation engine on the water problem, and that adds about 0.5% to Israel's GDP. It's not a drag anymore, right? They being a dry country is not a drag on their economy. They've made it, because of data and data use, to a flip to their economy. See, India is called the Startup India, and I invest in startups. And one reason I think the Startup India has not focused on these issues is there's no data, right? If I'm a venture capitalist, I want to know exactly how big that market is going to be that I'm going to address. And to predict things like market sizes and waste or water or something, you need to know how much the market size is, right? For which you need data again. That's not available in India. But coming back to Israel, I want to talk about the kinds of companies available. I think you told me earlier there were like a big data analytics and all of that. So there's one slightly creepy startup in Israel, which I saw. So what they do is they get utilities to sign up with them. And then they start mapping water uses across households. They use AI to study water uses across households, so they'll know exactly when people use the bathroom, when they shower, when they wash their car, you know, when they use their car. It's really creepy. So if by chance you took a shower at 2 a.m. and your utility happened to have signed up with that program, you would get a message saying, did you really shower? Or is it a leak? So it's a little creepy, but you know, that's the kind of analytic, that's where they are. You know, and when I was in this field and I visited Israel for the first time, there's something called the Ministry of New Tech, and it's like a kid in a candy shop. For someone like me, you know, to go in that thing and see all the innovations, really like a kid in a candy shop. It's creepy, but you know, for Indian cities that lose between one third to a half of our water, and you know what, I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine. Do we lose a third? Do we lose a fifth? We don't know. We just finished a study of about 1,000 households in Madurai on water and waste. Nobody was metered. So how are you going to know how much? We kept taking photographs of leaks. But again, you know, what conclusions are you going to draw from that? So I want to compare that to what can be done, you know, the kind of data we use. So as Shira mentioned, I'm an executive director in Sundaram Textiles. We and the sister company Dattatreya were the first companies to win the TPM Excellence Award, first textile companies in the world to win the TPM Excellence Award. And for those of you who don't know, TPM or Total Plant Maintenance is a very data-based program, right? So what we did is when we wanted to understand the water use and we had no clue, we put about 40 meters in different points. So first number that came up is we found out we were using about 3 million liters of water a month in our factory. And there was rampant disbelief. Where the meters, should they be recalibrated? We had a lot of problems, and I'm happy to talk to you offline on the kind of problems we faced. But the biggest thing is the orange is the farm within the factory. So if you visit our factory, you'll see that most of it is covered with forests and farms and all of that. And this is true in India also. Agriculture takes about between 80 to 90. And if you ask me how much, I don't know, because the data is not available. Right? So and the data is old also. So, but looking at this, we found farms took a lot more water than the factory did. But once we put the meters, we were able to identify the leaks, we were able to identify the problems, and the correction took 5 to 10,000 rupees. That's it. And we were talking before we came here that the poor in India pay about a rupee a liter. That's just price because of the water mafia and things like that. So if you actually put a price to the water, this becomes, you know, payback very positive. So what you can see is we've really, a trifling expense, just based on data, we were able to make real change. So I get asked this a lot, is adaptation possible, you know, given all the gloom and doom that you hear about climate change? And my answer is absolutely. But it is possible only if you have good quality data that is available to decision makers. So I'm not going to talk about this. So here is where I'm going to start asking for my favors, right? When writing this book, data or the lack thereof was probably my biggest problem, right? If I, the number of moving pieces in climate change are large, so it tends to be a complex science. So to persuade you to take action, I have to show you something, a threat that is credible enough, because action is not inexpensive. And any action I take will create a loser who will fight. So I needed to get data such as, you know, how are farm yields likely to fall in Vidarbha? I had this, but that's not enough, because there are variations within this. That's where this graph comes in. This is 100-year rainfall in Madurai, right? And this is the reason why I can't put the presentation out. So if you notice, this is around 1980, the rainfall starts falling. So, you know, you look at this data, you'll say, yeah, going forward, it's likely to fall. So I had India's top climate scientists come and say, you know, this data is wrong. So what you can't see there is, this is compiled from two data sets within Madurai. It's just two different gauges in two different places in Madurai. And he said, you can't combine the two. So I sent, staff from our institute went there and checked. There were 9 gauges in Madurai, most of which didn't have data in this time frame. So they had pieces of data available. Some of it, they do analytics in Pune to figure out, how to use the data. So we really need you guys to start looking at this because, otherwise if this is true, we're in a bit of a mess. So other data when I flew down to Bombay this time, I saw there was a smog. And I don't know how you guys are doing in your competition with Delhi on pollution. See, China used to be more polluted than Delhi. But sitting in Madurai, I could access online pollution data for any city in China and smaller neighborhoods within China and download it onto an Excel file. I can't do that. The Delhi, I think there are like 2 studies of disaggregated pollution data. So because China had such excellent data, they were able to bring down their pollution levels by about 20%, I think, in the last few years. But because we do not have that kind of online, inventory-wise pollution, that is what pollution is, a bucket term. It has multiple pieces inside it, and you need to know how much each of those are. And because we don't have that, I don't think we're anywhere close to solving the problem. Because whereas China is moving ahead. So I would like that if you can get me. Our forests are under, tremendous threat. A lot of that is because of grazing by farmers. We don't have man-animal conflict data at a level where you can start convincing people to take thing. I don't know how much water Bombay uses. I don't know how it's changing. I mean, I know it at an aggregate scale, but with the leaks and all of that, I don't know. And Bombay is probably the best city there is. If, we surveyed 1,000 households and 80% are not covered by meters, your guess on Madurai's water consumption is as good as mine. And if that graph is true, I need better quality data. We have 1 million people living there. I work in waste, right? I don't know how much waste we generate. I have 2 investments in waste. There is 1 startup coming to meet me later today. I don't know what the market size is. If I knew, it's a great sector to fund. It's huge, it's growing, but I don't know how big it is. So what can we do, right? So I'm now coming to we finished with the data part of the talk. Now we're coming to the decisions part of the talk. What can we do? Usually when I ask this question, they say the government should do something. But India is a democracy, right? And politicians tend to do what will get them re-elected. That's their incentive. And it's difficult to get re-elected on climate change because there was a survey done in 2011 by Yale University in conjunction with Seawater. They spoke to about 4,000 people. 41% of Indians didn't know what climate change was, never heard of it. And an overwhelming number, and I'll share this study with those of you who are interested, an overwhelming number felt it was something that affected future generations or didn't affect them too much. So with this finding, do you think anyone would make this a water or climate change a voting issue? No, they won't. I think Mission Kakati, in what happened in Telangana, I mean, it's a classic case study of what why governments won't care, which brings the focus back to the private sector, right? People like you who are inspired to act rather than leaning on the government. You know, if we're talking about national data sets, yes, you will need government help. But we're, in terms of adaptation, we're talking about local data sets, which is ideally suited to academic institutions and private researchers to start taking a stab at it. So let me now come to an allied point, which is data communication. Right, throughout this talk, we saw things that perhaps some of it surprised you. And somewhere where you saw a discontinuity between what is the data shows and what is talked about in popular media or the narrative, which is what people vote on and you get funded on. I mean, sooner or later, something there trickles through. And it's very important when you start looking at data quality, you know, data representativeness, etc., to also think of data communication. Many scientists, many academics look at research as cool and look at extension work, which is outreach, as uncool or infradig. Okay, and we are paying a heavy price for that because there are two worlds which are not talking to each other. So I'm going to end with a request, right? So that's if you're in data, please start thinking of climate change as one area where you want to start doing some research in. There is a desperate need for data in India. I mean, at the local levels, it's just not there. So if you want to do papers and stuff, you want to get published, there's plenty of room because there's nobody, I mean, there's very little data there. There's a lot of room to gather data sets, et cetera. Second, because academics tend to be perceived as trusted and unbiased, the focus on adaptation is smaller data sets, I think you're in a sweet spot. Third, whatever research you do, do think of outreach and data communication, because there is a huge gap which needs to be bridged. Thank you. Thank you very much. I just wanted to show you what can happen if you do outreach. This is my friend's water utility bill in Singapore. So when they actually have data, that's my friend's data, and they plot it month on month to show people exactly, you know, how they perform and hopefully motivate them to change. Now, I don't want to say we don't have data available. There's not enough recent data, especially in water.
Not enough, not reliable, all that. But India is also the world's hub
in supplying information technology. So if we take a look at that, this is the dichotomy. Why do we not use information technology, like these smart meters and everything that we have, to be able to capture the data which will be reliable and which can be sparsed in any way we want, we can be processed any way we want.
We can have all the bells, whistles, Wi-Fi.
Yes. So why don't we do that, and what are we doing in India to be able to capture the use of IT to be able to handle some of this?
That's a fantastic question. Anybody want to take a stab at answering that? No, I'll answer that. To me, energy is a no-brainer, right? India will get its carbon intensity down because it makes commercial sense. Finally, it's all about incentives, right? If you look at where I will measure only those things which are of value or of a cost to me, something I want to manage. Something like water, which is what I spend some time on, has never had a philosophy of management in India in the recent past. It has always been about provision as a right, not as a management as a responsibility, right? Energy in our factories, for instance, we are one of the most energy efficient factories in the world. And we do that because we make no money. Every unit I save there is a direct to my bottom line. So we have wonderful meters in energy and measuring that because we pay money for it and we want to manage it. Something like water, is the technology available? Absolutely. As you correctly said, we're the IT head. We can, if we put our minds to it, we can. But we don't pay a price for water, right?
But isn't it by the use of the technology we will save the cost of water to the people?
But why would we put it? I mean, the meters that I spoke of in the factory, my mother protested. Why are you spending lakhs and lakhs on these meters in the first? I paid for the, I wrote a check for the meter saying I'll put it, then we'll see what you can pay me back later. It doesn't cost us. We don't look at it as something to be managed. The shift is in the mind. It's not in the technology. We have the technology to manage it today. But great question. There's that gentleman behind you also, I think.
I want to add a point to you, ma'am, that in India, most of the colonies are unorganized and they are using groundwater also. So it is at that time it is difficult to check with smart meters and meters and to collect the data.
Absolutely.
They are using groundwater for most of the purpose. So sometimes it became difficult. As sir asked, like IT hub.
So very, you're absolutely right, which is why I don't view solar pumps as clean tech, because that severs the last link that you have between paying for groundwater usage of any form. If you want to look at it as a silver lining, the groundwater is running out very quickly.
Yeah, and ma'am, can't we,
so
instead of having water meters, can't we have wastewater generator meters?
See,
like reverse if, thing.
If you so notice, that Israel measures sewage, by the way. So industry has to pay for the sewage they let in. See, if you notice, this graph ends in December 2017. That's for several reasons. One of the things we did is the green and the yellow, we put sewage treatment plants. So we have a meter that says 12,000 liters of water that happens. So that's why I again and again emphasize the district and the city level. Only people like us who are running out of water and our only alternative is tanker water, for which I have to pay a lot of money, will find it worthwhile to invest in things like meters and in things like, you know, wastewater plants, because we have no option. I think you have to think of commerce as a motivating tool. In Bombay, for instance, I think you'll run out of landfill space fairly soon. So, I mean, the other area I focus on is waste. So, I mean, that may be something you want to start measuring. But I think some friends said you guys were, you know, water is also a problem. But I don't know whether I answered your question. Okay.
See, the reservation, he was there, is promoting lot of foundation and other things in such a way, reservation, rather than measuring and monitoring, you see, focus should be more on reservation water.
Reservation, you mean river qualities or water bodies?
Water bodies.
Okay, so water bodies, I can do a shameless plug and say, you know, I wrote 4,000 words on this. It's a more complex topic, okay? But the short answer is, India is one of the most land-scarce countries in the world, right? Many of the tank systems that we had, I mean, Madurai has a wonderful tank system. I think the Maharashtra parts of it have, Telangana has, Bihar has. If they're not connected tanks, because of the seasonal effect of India's water, we had tanks that were interconnected so the water would flow and get stored. But if you start encroaching any of the canals connecting the tank, the downstream tanks become empty. The moment they become empty in the middle of a city, they become wonderful sources to throw waste in. Right? So then the local residents come in. We all have short memories. Right? The Chinese have a wonderful saying that says, the faintest ink is better than the best pen. So we forget. So we just think this waste pile here. So the government says, you know, the Ayakat, the irrigation right, people have all sold the land around the tank. So now there is this tank with no rights, sitting in the middle of a city, just aching to be taken up by a developer. Right? And nobody is protesting.
There was water that comes from Kerala. Immediately after 1 month, there is a drop out. But the entire water has
but that's the whole thing.
Water is not absorbed by the soil.
I think I gave my copy of the book. If you see the rainfall patterns, that's what you're going to get. You're going to get more rainfall, as I said, on fewer days. Right? So you will have, and if you don't store, the next will be a drought. So, and because we're so land scarce and we have such a population, like why do I ask people to focus on animal conflict? You lose the forests. Forests are, all of the peninsular rivers don't come from snowfall, they come from forests. So you're not preserving water, it's preserving forests, but those forests are being lost to grazing. We have, I think, I don't want to say no hand, I think we have 300 million cows. There's 300 million bovines, cows, buffaloes, etc. And then we have a few hundred more million sheep. Where are they going to graze?
He's asking
He's talking about preservation.
Harvesting and, you know, check dams and all.
Are you talking about that?
Again,
all of this point on measuring groundwater, your point on preservation, again, it's a thing on management. India's philosophy of management, of managing water, is gone. It's seen as a God-given right to be provided by the government.
No, I think as a quote, ma'am, I don't agree. A lot of work is going on. You see, on water preservation and own water, if you look at Haryana, Punjab, huge water has been taken out from the ground. And our predictions are wrong. Let me tell you what technique we use all this prediction. People said, I stayed 18 years in Gurgaon. They said, in 10 years, Gurgaon water will be, you know, we have 600 feet water we are drying, and it will dry and city will be, you know, just it will dry and then the entire city will be displaced, all these things. Even Isle also, people used to say, so many years, you know, in 10 years.
So, anyway, years. Going on.
So still, Isle is there, still water is there, but our prediction also, you know.
But again, we need better quality data to predict,
yeah.
And we don't have time series of thing. But again, we don't manage. You're just giving me supportive data. We don't manage water. Electricity is free in Punjab. So you're growing rice, and they're exporting virtual water. And you're growing rice because you're so efficient in procuring rice. Today, when I talk to farmers in Punjab and say, why don't you grow vegetables? He said, why, madam? I don't get labor to grow vegetables. For rice, they've made it so easy. Punjab University has done a stand-up job. I can just go 2 weeks a year to my field, grow my rice, somebody will buy it efficiently, I'm done.
You just had a simple perspective. The question, if it's being asked, that why are we focusing on, why not focus on preservation and not measurement? You should do both anyway. You should do both anyway, because even if you want to do preservation better,
no, absolutely. But they're both data. Measurement and preservation are both aspects of management, right? So what I'm saying is we don't manage because we don't pay our whole philosophy. So thank you for the clarification. We should do both. We don't do both because we see water as a right and not a responsibility. Because we think it is some God-given, and you know, this is something I found out. You know, the change happened at British Times. And I will share stuff with you offline. But we've continued it, so I don't think we should continue to. But they're both, I mean, thank you for asking that, because they're both aspects of management, and we don't manage our water. We think it's the government's job.
Government is also promoting on the water harvesting projects. So nowadays, all of the new projects are coming, they are giving a clearance on the basis of that water harvesting schemes are there. But this is for the present, but what about the old one? They should also be considering to manage the quality.
Should is a difficult word in India, because who will implement the should? See, that's why, I mean, we do need, that's why I like hyper-local, because, you know, you have a hope in hell of influencing your association in your apartment complex. The should becomes very difficult on who will implement the shoulds in India, because there are so many competing pressures. You did a fantastic job. Yeah.
Then we had a crisis for low rainfall last year. and the dam levels were dropped down probably to 28-30%. Then eventually, City of Cape Town came up with a strategy to reduce the consumption level. So they put the water restrictions in such a manner. They put, I think the highest level was 6B, water restrictions. According to that, if you consume 1 kiloliter extra, then you will pay probably, you know, 10 times more than what you pay. So in the month of May this year, I paid 36,000 rupees water bill.
Yeah, so you really cared about managing your water, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
So that kind of restrictions. And
you should ask people here how much their monthly water bill is.
And then what happened, because of the water restrictions, the consumption level dropped down from 670 million liters to 450 million liters. And by the grace of God, we received 80% rainfall in the month of August this year. So there are no problems
now
in the coming few months or maybe couple of years. But still the restrictions are not lifted yet.
Yeah, because Cape Town actually, I mean, for those of you who are interested, when I wrote my book, I mean, South Africa is one of the case studies I use in how to manage water. Then the Cape Town crisis hit and my husband is like, are you aware that there is day zero and you've used them as the poster child for water management? And I said, no, you know, they are the poster child of water management because they really got demand down, like what he said. But your rainfall in your catchment areas also, my understanding is that it's falling. So you do need to, you can't get those restrictions off just as yet.
Well, it's a water
scarce
country.
And you need more
country.
Investment. So that's a political thing. There was one other question, I think.
And besides, lastly, I would like to mention the smart meter system they introduced accordingly. If you consume more than 300 liters of water, your water is automatically stopped. Whether you're showering or whatever you're doing, it is stopped already. That's how
yeah,
it
but
is.
But again, all aspects of management.
That's right, yeah. Thank you.
That's paid for by your 36,000 rupees also.
Yeah. So we were talking about where water is and where water is not. So there are two things, where water is and where water is not. And where water is, we have excess supply floods and to very low level. So what we're discussing is whether behavioral changes or policy changes, we're looking at local optimization. We're trying to optimize at those places. Because those, but if you look at the is not place, those places where there's not water, where they,
okay,
yeah, so
how do you get water? Yeah, no, no, so, I mean, before you get to where I think you're getting to,
yeah,
there is a, for me, the revelation, because we ran out of water and that's how I got into this, sewage is a wonderful source of water. I think in the green building thing, there was one person who spoke, they use their sewage for everything. But for us, sewage is always there. Whether it rains or it doesn't rain,
yeah, that's
sewage
what I'm
is
saying.
Always there.
Again, that is local optimization. What I want to say is where water is and where water is not. So I'm saying how to move water from where is to is not.
Yeah.
Maybe not at one go, but maybe multiple
yeah,
steps.
If you're talking
and
about,
we're looking at a global optimization.
If you're talking, oh yeah, you see, okay, let me tell you something. We'll optimize between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, okay?
Yeah.
Where water is and where water isn't.
Yeah.
Okay, my mother is from Karnataka, my father's from Tamil Nadu. We won't get. Right? And let's be very clear. Now leave Karnataka. We'll talk about Mandya farmers and Bangalore city. Where water is and where water isn't. They won't share.
But
that is, and it's going to go up.
But for those areas where you're seeing floods, right? I mean, they don't want so much flood. So I'm looking at that kind of thing.
It's a larger topic. We can take it offline. Happy to discuss afterwards.
Thank you, Ms. Mridula Ramesh, for such insightful talk. I request our Dean, Dr. Ranjan Banerjee, to please felicitate our keynote speaker for today. So with this, we have come to the end of our four-day conference, ISDSI conference at SPJMR. Now we are about to start the valedictory function. I'm sure each and every one of you here had a great time. So we had the opportunity to listen to eminent speakers and learn a lot about the area from them. We could listen to the presentations by research scholars on their research endeavors, and also we could network and interact with academicians, industrial practitioners, and students in this area. And as a member of the organizing committee myself, I had a great learning experience by being a part of this organizing committee. And so now we have the valedictory function to conclude the 12th annual ISDSI conference at SPJMR Mumbai. In this occasion, let's hear what the conference chairs, Dr. Sajeev Abraham George and Dr. Shriram Narayanan have to say. May I please have you both on stage, please?
Already we know that we are running late for lunch. We'll finish it as early as possible. Just a couple of days back, I think we were standing together at the inaugural ceremony, and this, like all good things, the conference is also coming to an end. It was a long journey. In fact, we started preparing for this conference maybe right from the first month. It's, I think, from January itself we started our preparations. We started setting up the website and called for papers, and it was a very, very, very satisfying experience. We never had any monotony of any kind. Though we had to do a lot of things, we never really felt that, it all happened naturally. And we had a lot of people who helped us in this thing. We thank everyone for that. We had the full support of DSI, we had the full support of ISDSI, we had the full support of the Institute. So with all this only, I think we could make this happen. In the beginning itself, the main objective that we had was we wanted to give the best possible conference experience, and that's what we focus, and we hope we have at least, maybe reasonably achieved that. That's what we hope. I hope all of you enjoyed this conference. I would let Sridham to take it forward, please.
Thank you, Sajeev. I just wanted to, all this is just an opportunity, an opportunity to start a conversation, and hopefully it's an opportunity to take conversations forward. So I certainly want to thank a number of people. I think on the ISDSI team, people like Dr. Maitri, Ravi Jain, and all of them, they entrusted us with the responsibility. So I just want to thank them. And of course, Sajeev and Debmalia were great support when we started putting this together. And I just can't thank Dr. Banerjee enough. I think he did not even ask us one question. He had total faith. He said, okay, you guys do what you want. I'm here to support you. And that's a fabulous support. It's sort of a word of confidence. And yes, absolutely, yeah. So, on the ground, there are so many people. I mean, Gigi, thank you very much for I think every time we had an emergency, we had to send her an email. Oh, what's going on? Some flight booking, and Gigi was right there, and all the students, absolutely fabulous experience. I don't think we could have had a better team to ask for. And on the DSI side, I think Jeet and Johnny have been great supporters. I mean, they've never asked any questions. All I had to do was pick up a phone and say, can we please do this? They would say, yeah, sure, go ahead, So, you can't ask for better collaborators. And of course, all the speakers who've come here, and I think people like Mridula and a number of other speakers who have come here. And so I think I feel like it's been a great learning experience personally for me. And I'm very, very grateful for this opportunity. I just want to say just quickly one more thing. When we started putting this conference together, one of the things that we sort of had extensive conversations about was two things that we wanted to deliver with a number of stakeholders in mind. So our stakeholders were people who are doing research, new faculty, PhD scholars, people who are from practice, so partly we wear dual hats. We wear hats as researchers, we wear our hats as teachers. And as a teacher, I want to go to the class and teach things that are relevant and important that my students should know, go out, do something about it. And I think some of the issues that we identified, you would have seen throughout the course of the conference, teaching panel, publication panels, the issues we cover. At least I hope at the minimum we've got some awareness about current issues. at least in the context of India. Hopefully, there are enough people here. You know, somebody's told me that if you exactly knew 7 people, you probably knew the world, you know, because of secondary connections, tertiary connections, a social network. I can see at least about 90, 100 here. So it just means that we probably know more than the world, I guess. But certainly, it's an opportunity for us to go start a conversation. So that's all I would say. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, Sajeev sir and Sriram sir. We have Mr. M.P. Jaiswal, President ISDSI, here on this occasion. Can I request sir to please come onto the stage and address the gathering?
Very good afternoon, all of you. And let me first convey my heartiest congratulations to the entire SPGN team for having organized such a wonderful and excellent conference, which has set a new benchmark for ISDI, I'm sure. And quality of paper, quality of panel discussions, and keynote address, and the last one which we have seen, which is really eye-opening in the green field, what we call is a environmental or carbon and whatever field. So. I think decision science, which basically talk about the data, and we all agree, or some of us, we don't agree that we don't have data, we don't have enough data, or we have proper understanding about the data, or use of data. You know, our country is supposed to be, stronger in decision science, but if you don't have real data, and data is not there, and one of the reason is management of the basic natural resource, which we all struggle, like water, or maybe tomorrow we'll also struggle for air, like the cities are getting air purifiers now. So we'll be struggling and buying even not only water but also air we need to buy, it looks that, in order to survive. So this also needs data, but as we all used to know that it's basically we are controlling carbon dioxide, but it's not necessarily that unless we have true data. So decision science has a greater role to play in the social application as well, not only in the scientific community but also in the social field. So that's one of the emergence of this particular conference. Next conference which yesterday we decided, and we'll be doing it Bhubaneswar. I am a director of Indian Institute of Management Sambalpur, and our capital city Bhubaneswar will be hosting this next ISDSI at the same time. And I would request you and your friends to plan your entire itinerary and also your research paper, and to come down to east of the country, and this is the west of the country, and myself and Kamlesh Mehta, we will be co-organizing in terms of research papers, and I am Sambalpur will be the host institution. We will actually come back to SPGN team to learn how they manage the entire program. I think our team has to learn a lot from your team, and we'll seek your support in terms of transferring the knowledge base, and also you have developed a lot of new apps, which we would like to continue using so that we don't have to reinvent the wheel. Bhubaneswar, as some of you must have visited, it's India's most smart city. It got award last year in the Paris, the best smart city of the from the India, and it has become top 20 smart city of the world. So it's the city of temples, because Puri is close by. It has Konark temple, it has backwater Chilka, and it has a lot of historical monuments for the tourism. Apart from this, the city has been hosting a lot of international events in the last couple of years. Last month, the city hosted World Hockey Cup, where more than 20 plus countries players participated. And also it has become one of the most investment destination of the country in terms of manufacturing and mining industry. So this is what I have to say, that it's a country, it is a city and surrounded by a lot of large operation companies, like mining, etc., in operation manufacturing. So there's a tremendous scope. Yeah. Dates will be 27, 28, 29, almost same, yeah, same dates. And so this is what I have to say. And thanks again for hosting for this conference, SPGN. And of course, ISDI and DSI team, so Jeet and Jeet is a great guru of this conference. For years, he has been supporting. And I'm sure he'll be continuously supporting and as a mentor and as a pattern for all these activities. And Professor Maitri, of course, is a pillar of establishing ISDI. And this is a team which is actually working. And we all are part of this. So I seek your support in terms of making the next event at least as good as what it was here. And whatever new thing can be done, we'll definitely try to learn from that. And thank again all of you, and particularly SPGN, for hosting this.
Thank you, sir. As I said earlier, SPGMR Mumbai is very proud to have been given the opportunity to organize this conference. And one of the key factors behind the success of this conference was the support from Dean Sir, as Sir mentioned before. So on this occasion, I request our Dean, Dr. Ranjan Banerjee, to please say a few words.
You know, I don't know how this is in the schedule because I wasn't even supposed to be here. So that's interesting. So four or five things, I think, very quickly. As an institute, we are grateful to ISDSI for giving us the chance to be a part of this. I think, you know, I had the first meeting with Dr. Maitri and the ISDSI team. Shriram has been in it. So our heartfelt gratitude, I think, we do want to do more. I think one of the bigger issues for us as an institute is we have embarked on an aggressive journey to upgrade ourselves on research. This will show results at a dramatic level in 2 to 3 years. But what we wanted to do in the interim is many institutes perceive us as a very strong teaching institute, a very strong industry interface institute, but not that strong in research. Conferences like this do a lot to change that perception. And we intend to, and we will do a lot more of this on an aggressive scale, because we are taking research and thought leadership very seriously. We appreciate your support. And I think much more importantly, as an institute, we have all made new friends. We have made new friends, new partners. I've always been saying this, that one of the problems is the Indian institutes are far more aggressive at collaborating internationally than they are at collaborating within. So, you know, if we make friends, then, you know, we are less bothered about, you know, whether X institute is higher than my institute, and say we are academics, we are in the business of service, serving society, improving student incomes, student outcomes, incomes also. And improving the quality of practice, and ultimately, therefore, improving the quality of society. So in that, I think we should not be competing, we should be partnering. I think that's the larger spirit of this. So that's the second thing. I want to make two or three points, very simple points. You know, this is a saying I'm very fond of, but I think it's very appropriate for conferences like this. A lot of good things get discussed. There is this saying where a notable management guru spoke for 2 days. And then at the end, the audience was asked, what was the most valuable session? And the feedback was resoundingly uniform. The feedback said the coffee breaks. Now, the management guru was actually very discouraged. But I think there's a big point. What is the point? You discuss and you provoke thought in this room, but the action gets done through the conversations outside. So it is the conversations beyond the session that determine what we will actually do data-driven decision-making, which is what research projects are getting generated, what is getting done in industry, are we going out and talking to you and say, hey, can we create some measurement experiments? So knowledge gets created when people take talk, convert it into new thought, convert that thought to actually taking decisions, using that decisions again to recreate more knowledge. So there is a cycle there, which is why I say the coffee breaks are important. Secondly, I'd like to congratulate, I think, two or three specific things. Sajeev, Devmalia, and the SPJMR team, I think they deserve a big round of applause. I think, you know, people are very nice in terms of thanking me. But one, I think SPJMR has always been a very strong institute. My largest contribution, and I think that's been my largest learning, I think the most important thing that you have to realize as a leader is that when you have good people, resist the temptation to add value. So a good leader, if you have the right people, add value when they ask you to add value. You should not feel the need to add value unnecessarily, because even if you can, you are stunting the capability growth of your people. So one of the most important lessons I have learned in leadership is when to get the hell out of the way. And you know, and then be a support. But okay, the second, and I think this is important, how the MBA students in this room, SPJMR MBA students in this room, can we just have them all standing up, please? A big round of applause, but I want to say one more thing. You know, to us it is very gratifying when people outside come and say that your students were sincere. We like their attitude. For us it is a very big thing, because I believe that sincerity, humility, and a sense of service are the things you cannot fake. And I think a group of discerning people, if they are giving you that positive confidence over a period of 3 to 4 days, of course there's a role that Sajeev has played. Of course there's a role that our team has played. But I think there is a role that you have played, and that you are inherently good people. And we are very proud of you for that. Thank you. Thank you very much. That's really all I want to say. The larger point, and I think one of the biggest contributions that this conference has made, is you have taken data-driven decision-making in the digital age and given it a broader interpretation. I think that broader interpretation is very important, because I think silos in management are grossly overrated, and they are honestly a throwback to the manufacturing age. The manufacturing age is dying, the information age is coming in. Our mindsets are siloed. So by breaking those mindsets, I think the largest thing we can do for DSI is, and I would like to see this, if I can humbly make some suggestion. Let's look at the DSI board in India. If 10 years down the line, you don't have faculty representation from every function, then you have failed. You need to broaden at a larger level. Because do you really think data-driven decision-making and information are the preserve of any one business function? So I think that's the next direction. I think you've set something, but there is a lot more to go. I think in terms of depth of interaction between academia and industry, we made a starting point. We're just scratching the surface. There is, again, a lot more to go. And for that, initially, when academia and industry meet, there is a lot of judgment. Industry says academia doesn't do this, it doesn't matter. Let that judgment happen, let that conflict happen. Without conflict and conversation, change does not happen. I think we made a beginning at this conference. There's a hell of a long way to go. We are very, very privileged. I'm sorry, I think I was just supposed to say a few words, but maybe I've said more than a few. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And as always, we never get bored listening to you. So now it's time to felicitate the doctoral students who have been tirelessly working towards coming up with innovative solutions to the present day problems in their research areas. So we appreciate each and every researcher who has come here, presented the paper, got it evaluated by the session chairs. But we have some of the best papers to be felicitated now. So we have the best paper awards. I request Professor Sridevi to please announce the awards. And I request again, sorry sir, Ranjan Banerjee to please... Maitri. Sir, please. to present the awards.
So this year we had about 100 people attending various sessions at the Doctoral Colloquium, and we had a total of 27 students presenting their work from different parts of the country. And we had six faculty members who served as mentors. They were from different parts of the world. And so we have two best papers. One is the paper titled Designing a Revenue Sharing Contract and Asymmetric Demand Information by Jaimini Bhattacharya from the Department of Management Studies, IIT Madras. Congratulations, Jaimini. And the next paper is Digital Divide Among the Indian Households, Extent and Correlates. This is by Chavi Asrani, a doctoral student at the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences from IIT Delhi. Congratulations, Chavi. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sridevi, Ranjan sir, and Maitri sir. So apart from the organizing committee, as sir earlier said, we had an app for this conference. And I think this is the first time that a conference had an app so that the participants can track their schedule seamlessly. So when this idea came up in the organizing committee, we thought of outsourcing it. But then we as a committee thought that we should give an opportunity to the students who are working in this area so that they get to learn from this experience. And also we get an app from their effort. So now it's time to felicitate those bright minds. They are students from the Sardar Patel Institute of Technology, which is in Bhavan's campus itself. So I request Mr. Vinay Gaddam and Praneel Satani to please come out to the stage. Let's have a loud round of applause for these young minds who made this app possible for us. Can I have Dean sir to please felicitate them? Now, on behalf of the organizing committee, I invite our conference co-chair, Dr. Devmale Chatterjee, to please address the gathering.
It's always very risky standing during two occasions. One is you and between your lunch and post your lunch, during the session. So these are, fighting the biological actions, and therefore I would try to make it very crisp. But before I think the chairs have already communicated what I also wanted to communicate, so I won't repeat that. But I thought I should speak about a small contribution, which started as a very small contribution by a person who started working in the team since the month of January, has handled over 450 submissions, has created the team, worked with the team tirelessly, has worked with, if not less than 10 vendors, 32 people, student volunteers, and three of us tirelessly, and we depended on her throughout the 11 months, and would like to call upon Gigi Santosh here on this stage, and I request Professor Jeet to please come here and felicitate the wonderful, wonderful contribution to the success of this event. Let's put your hands together once again for Gigi. Thank you, Gigi. Now, I don't know how should I call them. Our dean has already talked about them, and these are the rock stars of our campus, our student volunteers, and the team. Please come over. And please put your hands together for the wonderful, wonderful work they have put together, without which I don't think we would have reached 50% of the volume that we have reached today. Right. Oh. Wonderful. Please come. Come. So a small information to add to this is their sessions were on, and they have managed to attend the sessions because we have not given them any condonement for their absence from the classes. So we said you have to manage that and do this work, and they have done that with that clause. Come. So thank you one and all for your contributions, and I like to put on record phenomenal contributions from all the participants and speakers and all, and wish the ISDSI India team to do wonderful conferences in future, and wish them, you know, do better than what we have done this year. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words, and we are really overwhelmed by your appreciation. Now, I invite Dr. Jeet Gupta for the presentation of the DSI Awards.
Thank you very much, everybody. I came here to attend this conference thinking that I will have a time, I can sleep, I can relax, I can eat, and I don't have to work. All of that came true. I slept a little, I ate a lot, I talked to a lot of people, I rested a lot, but I worked a lot too. Attending some of these sessions, talking to the people, having some discussions and arguments. So thank you for all that. You know, people from abroad come to India, born in India, raised in India, think they know India. And we get humbled when we come to some conferences like this, when we find out that what we thought India is, isn't. What we thought we know about India isn't. So thank you for opening the eyes, at least of me and some of my colleagues who think the same way, educating us on the homeland that we belong to. I appreciate that. I think about the conference, the fact that we are Decision Sciences Institute, the fact that we are basing our decisions on the data and the analysis, expanding the scope of Decision Sciences Institute. by involving such aspects as social entrepreneurship, by involving such aspects as social responsibility, by involving such aspects as solving the water resource problem of India, by solving such aspects as thinking about smart cities in India. On and on I could go on. So I appreciate both the chairs to really expand the boundaries of decision sciences, and believe me, I'm going to take it back and talk to the board of Decision Sciences Institute to perhaps even redefine its scope and mission in the future as a result of participating in this conference. So I appreciate that very much. I also know that the conferences like this don't happen by themselves. I know we heard a lot about, you know, Shriram worked and Sajeev worked and all of that. But I think there is an institutional support that comes with it that makes it happen. And unless that institutional support is there, all that we do doesn't produce the results that we want to produce. SPJN Institute for Management Research provided that direly needed support without asking anything in return. We appreciate that on behalf of the Decision Sciences Institute Board of Directors, on behalf of the President, and on my personal behalf, I want to thank the SPJN Institute of Management Research for providing their support, and I would like Dean Banerjee to come forward. So, in addition to the support from the institution, I think the role of the conference chairs is critical. Without the conference chairs, and they are working tirelessly, selflessly, innovatively, nothing happens. All these things that I talked about, giving knowledge to the people coming from abroad, creating and expanding the scope, and all that, I really appreciate. I met Sajeev for the first time last year in Trichy, and I was not sure what we were going to get here, although I gave him a charge that he needs to do better than what happened in Trichy. Okay, I don't know whether he remembers that. Well, he has done that. He has achieved that. So, Sajeev, on behalf of the Decision Sciences Board, it is my pleasure. Ravi is the Vice President for the ASI for the Asia Pacific Division, so I take an opportunity to bring in here to facilitate the support. Okay. Yes, Jane. Okay. So, you know, we always put one conference chair from India and we put one conference chair from outside of India to balance the things a little bit. We think we know a little bit better. But I don't think we did. When Sriram Narayanan was put as a conference chair, and at the last conference they asked me, what do you think, will it be a good idea? I said, geez, that's great. I didn't know what I was getting into, and I didn't know what we are getting into. Sriram single-handedly has handled many of the things in this conference that we could never think about. His organization of the panels, reaching out to the people, making sure that the panels and the workshops fit into the schedule of the conference with Sajeev's help and with the Gigi's help and all of that, I think speaks for itself. When we talk about the innovation into the conferences, Sriram has really shown we can do the innovation and still succeed in a conference. Sriram, thank you very much. Now, I took one liberty with Shri Ram. Since Shri Ram comes from USA, I told my executive director, I'm not going to take his plaque to India that he takes it back to USA. I mailed his plaque to Michigan State University. Instead of that, I brought a certificate for him. Actually, you can sit down now. Sajeev, you come in. Sajeev, okay. Okay, I got two more awards to do, take care of. One, you know, program chairs cannot do it by themselves either. Conference chairs are there, they are too busy, they need some help. At least as a sounding board. When they are frustrated, they need somebody to talk to. When they cannot do something, they need somebody to come in and get the things done and all of that. So we have a conference co-chair. I mean, pardon me if I don't pronounce the name correctly. Devmalia Chatterjee. Okay, please step forward. Okay. His services were absolutely necessary for the success of the conference. Now I think I'm going to need Dean Banerjee here, please. Okay. The organizations work because there should be a leadership into the organization. ISDSI is one of that organization, and I had a dream long, long time ago that we got to have something in India representing DSI that provides the leadership, the guidance, and the management of the DSI organization in itself. Dream, when that dream starts becoming a reality, somebody gets scared, like me. But there are other people who make me stay on course. The president of the ISDSI, Dr. Abhijit Diwalkar, is one of those people. He has provided the leadership to. Thank you very much for your leadership, and I really, really appreciate that. Thank you all for listening to me and my talks and all that. I want you to know I grew up in India. I believe in one thing, and that is Nirvana. I tell my students, I believe in Nirvana. I'm not going to go worship on the mountains in the cold and the snow and all of that. I'm going to get my Nirvana by talking. And I do that extremely well. So in order for me to talk, you are essential for my Nirvana, because if you don't listen, my talk is not going to produce the Nirvana. So thank you very much. On my way to Nirvana.
Before we close this event, may we have the entire DSI and ISDSI team and the keynote speakers to please come onto the stage for a photograph.
Surprised, and Ajit, that's a good gesture from DSI, and the practice started this year, and I'm sure we should continue this for the encouragement of all, so I think we need to communicate to the board to continue this practice. This is really good and a fantastic gesture of DSI's involvement in whatever we are doing in this part of the world. Thank you. ISDSI Jeet, aye. Sir, Professor Maitri, aap to immediate past president hai, sir, aye. Professor Jaiswal, the new president, incoming president, Professor Abhijit.
Professor KK.
Kahan hai KK?
He's there.
Yeah, yes. Ah, the dean, he is the host, so he has to be the center stage. Aye. Come. Sriram.
We can call her also. May we have Meenu Tiwari ma'am also on stage, please? Sir, ma'am. Gigi ma'am, please. With this, we have come to the end of this event. Thank you, everyone. We hope you had a great time, and we really want to thank you for all the support given, and we would like to apologize for any inconvenience caused. Thank you once again.